Even now, many books and countless films have been created about the Vikings, but they are all still encased in a romantic halo. Here, the Vikings established many strange, if not terrifying, traditions, from the viewpoint of modern men. You are watching the reverse of history, and now we will tell you about the Vikings and their customs and rituals. Many Scandinavians migrated elsewhere to seek their fortunes between 800 and 1100. The Vikings, often known as the Norsemen, attacked British coastal settlements, particularly unguarded monasteries. They were pirates, raiders, traders, and settlers in a lot of Britain, Europe, Iceland, Greenland, and Newfoundland over the following three centuries. Contrary to what is commonly believed, the Vikings were not a race united by a shared history or sense of nationalism. The most well-known Vikings originated in Denmark, Norway, and Sweden, while historical accounts also refer to Saami, Finnish, and Estonian Vikings. They were not civilized in the local sense from a foreign country, and most importantly, they were not Christians. You will get to know this and plenty more in this video, so stay tuned with us till the end of this video. However, before that, here's a quick reminder that you can subscribe for free and like the video so that you can boost your algorithm. Comments are most welcome. Morals and lifestyle. In spite of the frequent raids, the Vikings indulged in farming, hunting, and fishing in their free time. In contrast to many other peoples at the time, the Vikings had exceptional traditions and customs. As an illustration, any transactions could be made by only saying the word. This was sufficient. Nowadays, it is difficult to fathom that breaking a word or an oath, such as lying, could result in death, on par with crimes like murder and theft, which would have meant that old breakers and liars would have drowned in the river. Such people were thought to be in a perpetual state of misery in the Scandinavian afterlife, where they would drown day after day in the waters of the underground river of Scandinavian hell, according to Viking beliefs. The Vikings believed it was improper to talk about a kindred person's sorrow unless the person specifically requested assistance. People who were angry were generally not worthy of a Viking, and Vikings never got into arguments with them. A stranger must also never be made fun of, since, according to the Scandinavians, mocking was always followed by a troll who would rip out the target's tongue. Additionally, the Vikings were extremely sensitive to the loss of their soldiers on the battlefield, hardly ever leaving them behind. The most intriguing aspect is that in this situation, the Valkyries scooped up the fallen warriors and transported them to the realm of Odin, because the only honorable death was one that occurred during combat. The souls of individuals who passed away at home and were elderly were transferred to another location, the goddess Hellworld. It was especially unbecoming for a man to pass away in old age, since in that situation, the enemy would have every right to mog the victim for choosing an unmasculine method of passing away. Because of this, older Vikings urged their family members to carry out a ceremonial killing before they passed away. Procopius of Caesarea, for example, wrote about this. They weren't designed to make the elderly or sick people live longer, but rather once one of them passed away from an illness or old age, he had no choice but to request that his kin take him off the living as soon as possible. Then someone, but not one of his family, with a knife, would be sent to him after they had built a big high pile of firewood and placed this man on top of it. This person's murderer isn't meant to have any connection to him at all. When word of the murder of their kin reaches them, they set fire to the entire pile of wood, starting at the bottom. They gather the bones and instantly bury them in the dirt after the fire is put out. Male and female slaves. The goal of any invasion was to increase one's standard of living, and the fate of seized men and women might vary greatly. Many were taken prisoner solely in order to be released in exchange for a ransom, and if no ransom was anticipated, the slave stayed at home. With the exception of artisans, who had a unique status, men performed the majority of the labor. Slaves had the legal right to marry, but only with their master's consent. Additionally, girls and women also assisted Viking wives at home because marriage was generally not seen as a family. Women slaves occasionally received very high positions in the Viking family, despite the fact that they had no rights, and some accompanied the Vikings on campaigns to satisfy any arising sexual cravings. It's odd that the Vikings themselves might end up as slaves. Adept, for instance, may be repurchased by his relatives if he was unable to pay off the debt, provided they could show that their own property was used to make the purchase. The transaction was deemed invalid, and all the slave's property passed to the master if it was used as a ransom. Aside from the fact that the master was accountable for the behavior of the slave's offspring were also treated as slaves from the minute they were born. For instance, if a slave killed someone, the master dealt with the victim's family. The slave's treatment subsequently received little attention. It is important to remember that the Vikings viewed the death of a slave as a dreadful dishonor that can lead to blood vengeance from the slave's family against the slave's master. However, if we ignore these encounters, it becomes clear that the Vikings also made an effort to defend slaves, since they knew that not every battle would be lucky. 1. Excessive murders distorted the gender ratio. The raid on the Lindisfarne Monastery in northeastern England by Norwegian Vikings in 793 AD marked the start of the Viking Age. Up until 1066, the Vikings pounded the coastline of Europe. One hypothesis holds that the male-to-female ratio of the Vikings was skewed through gender-selective infanticide. According to several researchers, the Vikings did not primarily conquer Europe to plunder. They preferred spouses instead. DNA testing on contemporary Icelanders provides credence to this idea. They examined the mitochondria that you inherit from your parents. There hasn't been much immigration to Iceland since the Vikings first colonized there more than 1,000 years ago. As a result, researchers were able to pinpoint the origin of Iceland's settlers. They found that 63% of female settlers came from the British Isles, compared to 80% of male settlers who came from Norway. That would indicate that men and women from the Viking invasion zones in Norway frequently interbred. It seems unlikely that the women would have traveled alone to Iceland. 2. Soup as medicine. Viking women became knowledgeable about war wounds as a result of the gory and brutal fighting that was a part of their daily lives. Particularly, Viking women had a system for judging the seriousness of a knife or slash wound. The wounded warrior would make a stew of onions, leeks, and herbs. After eating it, the women would smell the wound. They thought the wound was too severe to be healed when they smelled the stew. The women refused to help the dying warrior be healed, since they knew that they were going to die. Only the warriors who could benefit from their treatment would receive their time and attention. 3. Home gangs. The laws of the Vikings were very different from ours. It was forbidden to insult someone of high standing, yet it was occasionally acceptable to murder them. In a murder case, the killer might be killed by the family of the victim. Tribal wars broke out frequently as a result of this. Another technique for resolving disputes was home gangs. The criminal organization known as the Home Gang was not founded by the actor Ian Holm. These fights sometimes resulted in fatalities. Someone who had been wronged by someone else challenged them to a duel. The battle had to be fought within a week of the challenge, though a stand-in challenge might be used if required. Before the fight started, the challenger would read the regulations, which varied depending on the location. The regulations specified who might initiate the first strike, how many shields were permitted, which weapon could be used, how the winner would be decided, and what the winner would receive. In certain cases, the home gang could only be defeated by the death of one of the adversaries. If the challenged person did not show up for the duel, they were deemed guilty. Any member of society might theoretically justify murdering the accused if the offense was serious enough. As a result, if the clan chief skipped the duel, a slave may lawfully kill him. 4. Blood sports. Given the Vikings' passion for blood sports, their matches are more like ballet than UFC. Viking games were extremely risky and lethal. One of the activities they played was a swimming competition, albeit we use that term very loosely. To see how long one man could keep his opponent submerged was the object of the game. Men probably died because they couldn't escape to safety. In another game, two teams compete with a ball in what essentially amounts to a full contact version of keep away. Despite its reputation for being bloody, the game was only played once a year, in the fall. The sport of wrestling was also highly valued in the culture of the Vikings. Even when they weren't actively robbing settlements, it helped them keep themselves in shape and prepared for combat. As if playing the games wasn't dangerous enough, brawls and fights may start at any time. On one account, a number of youngsters were playing a game. After being roughed up by another youngster during a game, a 6-year-old boy smashed an axe into his skull. If disputes weren't resolved on the pitch, they might turn into protracted blood feuds. Due to the level of violence present in the games, one warrior who was still capable of engaging in combat was compelled to watch from the sidelines. 5. Pagan sacrifices. Observing a blot on the winter solstice, the Arab adventurer Al-Tartucci described how they hold a festival at which everyone assembles to worship the deity and to eat and drink. On the winter solstice, spring equinox, summer solstice, and autumn equinox, this rite took place 4 times a year. At the farm's entrance, a sacrificed animal is set on stakes, and the person who killed it is in charge of removing the head. He must perform this for the benefit of his god and so that everyone may see his sacrifice. While some gods only required material goods or money as tributes, others, most notably Odin, Lord of Valhalla, frequently required a living sacrifice in keeping with his status among the gods. At Onshold, a contraction of Odin's holt, which means Odin's wood, there is substantial archaeological evidence that both animals and humans were hanged and bloodied for ritual sacrifice. The saga of Harald Fairhair's son, Håkon the Good, goes into considerable detail about a massive blot sacrifice. At a nearby temple, several animals, mostly horses, would be sacrificed, and their blood would be splattered on the spectators and the walls of the temple. The flesh was sacrificed, consecrated, and then devoured with gusto while numerous toasts to the gods, starting with Odin, were made. A sacred tree in Uppsala, a Norse religious place, was decorated with a horse's blood according to the Hervarar saga. 6. The festival of Hestav Hestav, an awful duel between two stallions, is said to have started in Norway during the Viking Age, particularly in the Icelandic Commonwealth between 930 and 1262 CE. A center of Viking culture and society was Hestav. Horses in the wild compete for mates, and the Hestavg is a man-made version of this. The competition revealed the horse's strength and distinguished the top horses for breeding. A ringed area was historically intended to prevent the stallion from escaping the confrontation, as would typically occur in nature when two stallions were introduced to a mare in heat. The mare would then be chained in the center of the enclosure, or occasionally outside, but still within the other horse's scent range to provoke competition among them for her. The horses would be startled or lashed into fighting if they resisted for any reason. The Hestav was believed to last anywhere from 15 minutes to more than 3 hours, with rounds added to break up the relentless animal savagery, and it typically ended with a participant being killed or seriously injured. 7. The terrifying Eric the Red. The Vikings were fierce warriors who were devoted to their cause and aggressive, but Eric Thorvaldsen was too vicious. Eric was born in Norway in 950, and his family moved to Iceland when he was a little child when his father was expelled for murder. Eric's nickname refers to his fiery personality and red hair. He would lose control of his temper about the year 980. In Haukadal, Iceland, Eric's workers produced a landslip that wrecked his neighbor's home. Eyjolf the Foul, the man's kinsman, executed the servants as retaliation. Eric killed Eyjolf and a clan enforcer out of rage. The relatives of Eyjolf demanded justice, therefore Eric was banished. Eric moved his family north, but they remained in Iceland. On Oxney Island, they developed a farm. Once they were set up, Fran the Dueler, a new neighbor, asked Eric if he might borrow some religiously significant wooden beams for his dwelling. Eric agreed, but Fran objected when he went to get them. Two of Fran's sons and a number of his acquaintances were killed in the ensuing fight. Eric was once more banished. In Greenland, the earliest settlers were Eric and his family. After his exile was over, he went back to Iceland and persuaded others to travel to Greenland. Eric and his family moved into one of the two colonies, where they lived the rest of their time. About 500 years before Columbus, his son Leif Erikson was the first European to sail to North America and found colonies. 8. The Blood Eagle. Given the appalling conditions of Viking culture, it is hardly surprising that they are charged with inventing the Blood Eagle, one of the cruelest and most excruciating methods of execution. This method of execution involved tearing out the victim's lungs, which were then hung over his shoulders to give the appearance of wings via the gap left by the brutalization. Only twice of the known Norse tales feature the Blood Eagle, but other texts make references to it. Both victims were royals who were murdered by a son in retaliation for the death of their father, demonstrating that this method of execution was only used for those with special significance and goals. Halfdan Haleg, also referred to as Halfdan Longleg, was offered to Odin as a sacrifice by Torf Einar. Einar made them carve an eagle on his back with a sword, removed the ribs from the backbone and dragged the lungs thereout, and presented him to Odin for the victory he had won, he said. Ivar the Boneless executed L.A. of Northumbria in 867 CE in retaliation for the murder of his father, the legendary Viking chieftain Ragnar Lodbrok, as described in the tale of Ragnar's sons. The account claims that after being taken into custody in York following a struggle, they carved the bloody eagle on the back of Lá. Then they took away all of the ribs from the spine, and then they ripped out his lungs. The Vikings certainly lived up to their reputation for brutality. In your opinion, the most disgusting thing that was normal for the Vikings? Do let us know in the comment section below. If you enjoyed this video, please hit that thumbs up. It will help us to understand our audience and allows YouTube to suggest similar videos to you. Thanks for watching. We hope to see you at the next one.